season of our marriage where we had hit rock bottom, and we went to a Christian marriage intensive for a weekend and here in Texas. And the last morning of that, some graduates of the program, kind of like the mentors of our class of all the couples that were there, they shared the story of the kintsugi art. And it just really, really resonated with me. I always thought we had a fantastic marriage. I always thought in a, you know, 1 to 10, I always thought we were a 10 for 20 years. It wasn't until we, that everything fell apart that I realized that there was 2 decades of stuff I didn't know.
I was definitely not in a good place and doing things obviously that I shouldn't have done. And I mean, God really brought me to, I mean, you know, kind of the road in Damascus where, you know, I woke up and literally had to like make a choice. Was I going to take the narrow path or was I going to take the wide path? And I mean, I literally, you know, just called out to God and just said, okay, you know, what is it? And basically, you know, it's hard to say, but what I heard was a good life wasted. And like as clear as day, I heard that, a good life wasted. And I thought to myself, I'm like, okay, that's not what I want the message of my life to be. You know, that's not how I want the journey of my life to be. And what I had to do personally was I had to fully surrender. Like I had known Christ and I had had Christ in my life, but I always felt like, okay, there's a certain segment of my life that it's just me. It's about me. And it's about really the fruits of the flesh, right? The things, you know, I needed to do more. I needed to make more money. If I didn't do it, it wasn't going to be taken care of. And at a point you really just wake up and you realize you're literally and figuratively at the bottom of a pit. And I'm like, okay, how did I get here? It wasn't easy. No, brutal.
Brutal. It's, we've lost family members, and the grief of what we went through in our marriage is as painful. It's like literally being in a tide, in an ocean, and just tidal wave after tidal wave after tidal wave. God forgave me, and what Jesus did on the cross for me, that my husband was asking for a second chance. I had to give him that. I wanted to see the new man that he would become someday. I'm so happy with where we are now. And I'm so glad that we didn't give up. Mm-hmm. I mean, we fought hard, really, really hard. There were a lot of hard days, a lot of hard nights, a lot of talking in our closet, a lot of like taking conversations out. It is so important to surround yourself with other people. Do not ever isolate yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, your marriage will be stronger when you surround yourself with other people to come alongside you and, you know, and stand in the gap.
The kintsugi bowl for us has been quite literally, you know, we started this with just like, okay, this has been healing for us. We're going to do this just to see. And like quite literally, God has blessed this like so abundantly. Michelle was literally like one morning, she's like, okay, I want to be able to point people to a message about being broken and being kintsugi. Not even 2 hours later, like the email came in and said, hey, our church is doing a deal. And we're like, and Michelle's like, okay, like, okay, how, like, how does this happen? Like literally like, okay, this can only be by him. And the messages and the feedback and the thing about it is, it's like, we haven't done any of this. We've done nothing. Everyone has a story. Everyone is broken, but everyone's scars are beautiful. And, you know, it's all how we're put back together.
Your story isn't over. It's not, like, for me, I thought that our love story dating all the way back to 11th grade was just the most beautiful thing. And then all this stuff happened. And for whatever reason, that crushed me. For years, that crushed me. And that now I'm like, okay, our story is so much more beautiful now than, like, it's not worth it. You know, I didn't need to throw it away or think that it was, you know, bad or whatever. You know, even the fact that you all started your message series the week of our 25th wedding anniversary. And that was just glorious in and of itself.
Isn't that just amazing? You know, when we started this series, we never had a plan to have a testimony for week four. We just wanted to show each of our other three preparing their bowls. And after we reached out to Michelle and asked her to create this bowl for us and tell us more about kintsugi and this art and what this all can mean, we realized that she had a story too of healing. And you heard it there in his voice. He had to surrender to God. And that's what today is going to be about. We know that God brought all of this together for us so that we could connect with the Lord. And that is what the Spirit does. And that's why we've been focusing on the fruit of the Spirit. Let's think about just all of these weeks, because we had four primary messages to think about. First off, we know we're going to struggle. So how do we struggle well? And when we start to do that, you know, God is then asking us, hey, why don't you wrestle now? Wrestle now with your faith. Wrestle now with the problem you might have. Wrestle now with your doubt. Don't wait till later. Later means never. Let's do it now together. And then God invites us to begin the healing, but we have to heal together. We never heal in isolation. And they gave that testimony as well this morning. And today we finish our series by talking about how we need to surrender. But when we surrender to God, we actually surrender stronger. And so that is what today is about. And I want to turn to some words that Jesus said. When Jesus is talking about this word surrender, what it means to surrender to God, this is from Matthew chapter 16. Jesus is talking to his disciples, but he's also talking to us for sure. He says, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way. Take up your cross and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, if you surrender, you will save it. It's when we try to hold on to it ourselves, when we try to do things our way, that we actually lose life. It's when we control. But when we surrender to Jesus, he's telling us, you're actually going to find your life. You're going to save your life. You're going to have a better life. You're going to have a new life. And he's teaching us a truth here. And the truth is this. The truth is that resistance is far more costly than surrender. Now, I could easily prove this eternally. Like, for your eternal destination, of course, resistance is costly. It costs you everything. And God's given us such a good promise. But it's true now as well. It's true in that life, but it's true in this life you're living right now. That resistance is far more costly than surrender. Living in the way of the world is so costly. Now, living Jesus' life does mean taking up a cross. It is not an easy road. It is a narrow road. But it is so much more beautiful. And for those of us who have been following Jesus for a long time, we have realized that. We have seen that happen in our lives. And we've seen it happen in the lives of others. Our guide for this series has been the fruit of the Spirit that Paul talks about. And each of these words is so, so important. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. We haven't spent a lot of time like diving into the individual words, but I hope that you have. I hope that you've kind of singled some out and talked to the Spirit and asked the Holy Spirit to give this to you, because God wants to listen to you and the Holy Spirit wants to respond to you. So I hope that you've been praying through these. But my wife got me thinking. She said, you know, as you're going through this and you're kind of thinking through these words, one of the best things you can do is change your translation of the Bible. I'm like, oh, it's so often true. Have you ever done that in a Bible study where you're reading through the scriptures and you want to go a little deeper, and then you actually turn to another translation and it just gets you thinking a little bit differently? And she said, Jim, you need to try this. And she's usually right when she tells me to do something. She says, get them to read the Message translation. And this is what it says in the Message. It's a little bit more wordy, but I think it's an amazing just thought provoker. But what happens when we live God's way? He brings gifts into our lives, much the same way that fruit appears in an orchard. Things like affection for others, exuberance about life, serenity. We develop a willingness to stick with things, a sense of compassion in the heart, and a conviction that a basic holiness permeates things and people. We find ourselves involved in loyal commitments, not needing to force our way in life, able to marshal and direct our energies wisely. I think it's beautiful to do that. I think it's beautiful to turn to the scriptures and just to like sink in. And you're thinking about a word like peace. And of course, here in the Message translation, they translate it as serenity. How does God get this peace in our lives? And what can this look like? What would it taste like in our lives to others as they experience our fruit? What would they sense if they're able to be around us? And I think that's the Christian walk. I think the Christian walk should be one that's not perfect, but so beautiful, so sacrificial, that people want to be around it. Even when they don't understand the faith fully, or maybe they don't know God personally yet, but when they see the Christian walk, that it's just so attractive to them that they want to know more. They want to know the reason for the hope that you have. And we know sometimes that's not the case. But here's the thing, and I think this is a truth that I've been wanting to say since week one. I've been wanting to say it, but I've been holding back until week four. This is what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit grows spiritual fruit, not religious nuts. And for a lot of us, we spend a lot of time around religious nuts. But that's not the image the Bible gives us. That's not the picture of the Christian walk. We're not to be religious. No, the Spirit grows spiritual fruit. Spiritual fruit. And that's the kind of spiritual people that I want you to be. Not people that are just religious on the outside, but people who love God and love each other and love the world on the inside. And then you express that on the outside. I know it's hard. You know, sometimes in our walk, there's things that get in the way. It's hard to know how to surrender. I think in our culture in particular, imagining giving up control and surrendering to anything, even God, can be a little hard. But it's always been that way with people. I think back to the founding of God's people, Israel, the Jewish people. And in Exodus 16, God has led them out of Egypt, out of slavery. He has led them across a sea. He has rescued them from the most powerful man who led the most powerful army in the world, Pharaoh's Egypt. And yet, as they're there and they are rescued and they are free, this kind of thing comes up in their life when they're in the desert. They grumbled against Moses and Aaron. They grumbled. And grumbling can obviously, if you're looking at a real problem in life, grumbling can be justified. But there's some people that just go through life grumbling, complaining. I call it whining. Like whenever you see somebody who's my age, who's grumbling a lot, who's complaining a lot, just tell them, hey, only 2-year-olds are allowed to whine. That'll get a guy's attention. But that's what the Jewish people were doing against Moses and Aaron, and by the way, against God as well. And so the Israelites were saying to them, if we had only died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. Okay, so death is better than what they're experiencing. There, we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. Yeah, but you were slaves, and I don't think the food was as good as you remember it. I'm sure it's what you were used to, but I don't think it's as good as you remembered it. But you, Moses, and your God, you have brought us into this desert to starve this entire assembly of people to death. You have done this. Your God has done this. They didn't think God was going to provide. They think God got them out of Egypt with all those plagues that happened against the most powerful military in the world across a sea. And then God didn't even have it in mind to provide for them. Of course, that's silly. But God realizes they're not at a point yet where they're willing to surrender to me. They don't trust me. They don't know me. So it would be one thing to just help them grow some crops or something like that. But if I do that, they're going to think that they were in charge. So God comes up with a special way to feed them. And of course, he always planned to take care of his people. That should never have been in question. And so what he did is he rained manna from the sky every day for his people. What is manna? Sometimes we translate manna as bread. In Hebrew, it means, what is it? Literally, the Hebrew people called it manna. But what is it food? We don't even know what it is. It's a different kind of food. In the Bible, it describes the flavor. It describes it like a honey gram kind of taste. So every morning, they got to gather like honey gram cereal. And it takes care of them. Well, they whine about that. Oh, we're always eating the same thing. We don't get any meat. We used to get meat in Egypt. And so what does God do after that? In the evenings, he rains down quail fajitas. I don't know if they were for fajitas, but I'm from Texas. That's what you do with quail. You wrap it in bacon, stuff it with a jalapeno, and you make fajitas. So good. So good. I can only imagine being a chef there. And as people are going through the line, they're complaining and complaining. I promise you, in my kitchen, if you complain in my kitchen, you go to the back of the line. That's exactly what I would have done. And I think in some ways, that's what happened to the Jewish people. God was providing for them, but they continued this complaining. And it wasn't until they were ready to be mature, to know God, to worship God fully, to say it another way, until they were ready to surrender, that God was going to take them into the promised land. Well, how much training did it take? It took 40 years. Do you know God could have had them in the promised land on foot within weeks? But they weren't ready. And I think for a lot of us, this is what happens. We want this thing, and God wants to give it to us. But we're not ready. Hearts aren't ready. Our faith isn't ready. We haven't surrendered to the right kind of God. And sometimes God knows, hey, I'd love to let you hit the lottery. But you wouldn't know what to do with it if I gave it to you. Now think of life that way. Because the promise with God is clear. If you can surrender to God, God's going to help you surrender stronger. You're not surrendering to God and becoming worse. You're not surrendering to God and becoming weaker. God always wants you to be stronger. And so that's the truth of what he's always teaching us. And that's where the fruit of the Spirit leads. The kind of people who have love and joy and peace and patience, they are stronger people. You can't always tell it on the outside, but I guarantee you they are on the inside. And part of the reason is because they smell like God. They act like God. They're treating people like Jesus treats people. And that is beautiful, and it is a stronger way to live, and it's what God wants to do in our lives. By becoming less of yourself, you become your better self. You become the one that God always designed you to be. And that is an amazing person that all people want to be around. Because the way that God knit you together in your mother's womb, you were going to be perfect for the world. And I know sin has gotten in the way, and we all live in the midst of this brokenness. I'm broken. But what God's message to us is, you can find your okay in the midst of your brokenness. Let's put this back together. The way I designed you to be is amazing. And what we want at Messiah is we want to help you discover that. We want the Spirit to reveal it to you. And day after day, we all want to grow. We want to surrender and we want to grow stronger and allow God to do the work and for us to have our focus there. Now, surrendering to God is a big thing. And you might say, why would I do this? It seems like such a risk. Well, if you go to the last chapters of the Bible, I want to spoil the story for you because it's in the last chapters of the Bible where God gives away the secret early. He took one of Jesus' closest disciples, and at this point, he was the last disciple living. But God had one last message to give to the world. So he invited John to take a peek into heaven. That's what the book of Revelation is. John is taking a peek into heaven. And the whole book, and maybe it's misunderstood by some people or they're not exactly sure what all these symbols are. I'm going to tell you what, go to the end, and when you figure out the end, you're going to understand almost all the rest. In Revelation 21, God gives us the great story. He gives us the great ending to everything that he's been doing about the story of the world, the story of creation. He says that God is going to wipe every tear from their eyes. Why should you surrender to God? He wipes away tears. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. Why should you surrender to God? Because he wipes out death. He wipes out mourning. He gets rid of all the pain. For the old order of things has passed away. That's where we live right now. We're in the old order of things. It's time to be about something new. And then Jesus, the one who has given his life for the world, but he is risen and he is alive. He has ascended to his Father. Jesus is waiting to say these words to the world. He's waiting to fully reveal God's heaven. And Jesus says these words, I am making everything new. Jesus is saying about your life, I am making everything new in your life. Let me. I've sent my Spirit into the world and to work in you. Put your faith in me. I am making everything new in your life. What an amazing message. But Jesus doesn't stop there. He doesn't stop there. Of course, the dominant thing that we've talked about during the series is the art of kintsugi. Japanese art of taking something that's broken like a bowl and putting it back together, but you put it back together with these gold lacquer, these gold seams. And what was once broken is now put together and it's more valuable than it was before because the thing that has sealed it together is more valuable than it. And today, I actually put something that is pretty near and dear to me. This is a cherry tree, but it's a grafted cherry tree. It's a young, young sapling. This one's brand new. It's ready to be planted when it's planting time. But it's a grafted tree because in grafting, what you can do is you can take the branches of other types of trees and you can graft them on as long as they're from the same genus. So, for example, a cherry tree is a stone fruit tree. This one has been grafted together with four different types of cherry trees. So after a few years, it'll take a few years to get all the fruit, but maybe in year one or year two, we might get the original fruit of the original stock. But a year or two after that, we'll start to get fruit from the others, and suddenly we might have Bing cherries on here and all other different kinds of cherries. You could actually graft onto this tree, and I don't know how to do this at all, but you could graft any kind of stone fruit. You could put peaches on it, or nectarines, or apricots, or plums, even almonds. Could you imagine this cherry tree in my yard one day out in Defiance, Missouri? And I've got cherries on it, and then there's almonds sprouting out of the thing, and there's nectarines sprouting out of the thing. People are going to walk up and think something weird's going on. Well, something is. Because this pastor loves what God's up to. And this pastor wants his whole life to look like that. Because there's something that happens in Revelation 22 that's really, really important. And it kind of seals up the whole thing. In Revelation 22, John is left with the last image. the last thing that God wants them to see. And it says that the angel showed John the river of the water of life. And it was as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. So he's looking at God's heavenly city. We were born in a garden, but we lost the garden. The last image, something that God's been up to the whole time, is making the garden into a garden city. It's a garden city. We were meant to tend the earth and to grow this garden city, but we lost our place next to the tree of life. On each side of the river stood the tree of life. See, in Genesis, there's a tree of life. In Revelation, tree of life's now everywhere. There's lots of the tree of life. And what does it do? It bears 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. And no longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. This is a grafted tree. Paul talks about this. Paul says that all of us can be grafted together on the rootstock of Jesus and be called the people of God. And so this tree is symbolizing something for us. It's saying that it's got all these different kinds of fruit that are able to grow there. Just like you and I, we all serve the same God, but we have different gifts. And even the leaves are for the healing of the nations. The healing of the nations. I think you can tell the whole story of the Bible with just the image of tree. Just the image of the tree. Back at the beginning, you had the tree of life, and the tree of life gave life to the original people. But when they ate from the tree of wisdom, which God told them not to, he didn't want them to know good and evil. Because when you know good and evil, that means evil's in your life. He only wanted them to know good. He only wanted them to be attached to the tree of life. And that tree was lost. And then God's talking about this new tree that's going to happen. It'll be the tree of life again, except it's now going to have all this fruit on it. Different kinds of fruit. And its leaves, when they're finally ready, this one's just got a couple little leaf buds that are about ready to go. They're going to be used for the healing of the nations. We live between the trees. God made something really good. And God's going to make something good again. But in this life, we stand between the trees. One of my favorite pictures of the cross of Jesus is that the cross of Jesus is often called not a cross. Sometimes it is. But in the Bible, it's often called the tree. And so between the tree of life that was lost and the tree of life that's going to come, we have another tree. Yes, it's Jesus' death tree, but it brings life. It brings healing and it brings forgiveness and it brings love back into the world. And it does it now while we're living here between the trees. And we think about the Bible and this life as a story of trees and everything that we've experienced going between them. We can see that what this tree does is it brings the two together. It breaks into the story because we lost this one and God wants to give us this one. Yeah, I thought about the healing leaves that's talked about in Revelation 22, these healing leaves. Did you know leaves have always been used to heal? They always have. You probably know that aloe is good for sunburns, but did you know that the ash leaves were often used to treat jaundice and gout? Or that back in the day before they had stuff in the medicine section at your pharmacy, they used maple leaves to help nursing mothers when they were sore after they nursed their babies? Or that alder leaves can be used to treat tonsillitis, but also hemorrhoids. Just hopefully not at the same time. Because that would be quite gross, right? And that fig leaves were used to treat diabetes. I don't even know if they knew what it was. It's to treat cholesterol and to treat skin rashes. By the way, what did Adam cover himself with in the garden? What did Eve cover herself with in the garden? Fig leaves. I kind of wonder if they got into some poison ivy when they were in the bushes and they were hiding from God. I wonder if they ran into a little more trouble than they anticipated. Because when you hide from God, what happens is life tends to attack you. All kinds of things start getting in the way. And so they're hiding themselves with these fig leaves. Well, what was once used to cover our shame, God's now using to heal the nations. Maybe it's some physical healing, but I bet a lot of it's emotional healing. And man, we've never needed this message more in the world, that all the political divides that are in the world, all the social divides that are in the world, all the economic divides that are in the world, all the different ways that we are divided as people, God is bringing the nations together. Revelation 22. The fruit and the leaves for the healing of the nations and the healing of the world. This is the promise that God has given us. This is why you surrender stronger. This is why you submit your life to Jesus and you follow Jesus. And here's the key question for all of us. The key question we asked it at the beginning of the series, and I think it's really important now. At the end of your life, what do you want people to say about you? That's exactly the question that we heard in the testimony today. He was worried that the direction of his life was going to lead him somewhere that he didn't want it to go. He didn't want that to be his legacy. And neither do you. You don't want the story of your life to be a story of brokenness. You want the story of your life to be okay in the midst of your brokenness, to be healed in the midst of your brokenness, and God wants to do that for you. What could happen in your life if you didn't let your struggles stop you? That's everything that God's been teaching us this whole time. So this morning, we're gonna close the message with a song. And it's a song that I've heard on the radio a lot of times, but it's actually by Avril Lavigne. She's not a Christian singer. But I think what happens often in this life is it's not just the Christian voices that notice the problems that we're going through. I think everybody in the world understands it. We all know, we all feel the brokenness that's going around us. And so as we close the message with this song, this is what I hope you do. Just take a moment to listen to it and to talk to God and to ask God, how can you surrender stronger? And what's God going to do in your life if you do? God bless you. Amen.